All right. Hey, everybody. It's Daphne here at Laura Entertainment. We are sitting down with Roddy Radiation Byers. How you doing, Roddy?
Pretty good. Thank you.
It's been a crazy time entering in here, huh?
Yeah, well, we're on the road to Palm Springs, so.
Were you up there?
I can't remember.
They all look the same after a while.
Well, you know, I don't really need to know. All I need to know is what time I'm on stage.
So how long have you been doing this? You've been doing this for a while.
Well, this tour, I think this is just getting near the end of the tour now, the last four dates. I've been over in the States for 3 weeks.
For 3 weeks? Oh, you've been over here for 3 weeks?
Yeah. Yeah.
And you have four more shows?
Four more, yeah.
So do you ever book, is everything that you book, is it out on the West Coast?
Well, my band over here is all based on the West Coast, but I have done the East Coast with another band backing me, with Scotch Bonnets. I did two tours with them and Midwest as well and the South.
So, how's tour life? You ready to go back home for a break?
I'm missing my grandchildren.
Yeah, I've got some myself. I know that feeling.
Yeah, mine are real cute. Got four.
Four. I'm two up on you, man. I got six.
Crikey. You win. You win.
So, tell us about this song, Concrete Jungle.
Oh, right. Well, I wrote it in 1976 when I was a punk band called the Wild Boys. And when I joined the Specials, we started doing it with the Specials, you know?
The hit. It's definitely
hit. Well, yeah, well, it's a shame it was never released as a single. I think it was released in, where was it? Somewhere else in Europe. They put it out as a single.
They didn't release it over here?
Not as a single, only on the album. Oh, first okay. album. I sang it on the first Specials album, uncredited for some reason. So I wasn't the lead vocalist. And Elvis Costello didn't mind me singing my own song, which was kind of nice. I don't think Terry Hall, the singer, was very pleased, but there you go.
So, I have a question for you. Well, this is more or less the reason why I do these interviews is to help aspiring artists.
Right.
I don't know if Bobby had told you that, but do you have any advice for anybody who's aspiring? I mean, there's a lot of musicians out there, I know, but as far as touring, getting into the business, any advice? Yeah.
Well, you've got to do it because you love music, you know? You've got to really want to do it because you love the music. You don't do it to become a star or make a lot of money because not many people do, you know?
That's true. I'm in the film industry. I'm actually a film producer. I produce movies, TV shows, and that's what I tell everybody in the industry all the time. You know, if you don't like this job, you can't just get in this business thinking that you're going to be famous and you're going to be rich because it doesn't work like that.
I kind of like, I used to watch the Monkees TV program as a child, I suppose. And I really fancied living in a beach house, playing music surrounded by pretty girls. But that was not the reality of being in a band.
Yeah, when you're touring, you don't have, there's no beach house you can take with you. Oh, I think
it's in Long Beach, and I have my own room and bathroom, and they're really nice to me. They look after me, you know. So, you know, in between shows, I got somewhere to rest up, you know.
There you go. That works. I mean, it's not all glamour, and it's the same way in the film industry.
Well, you know, I've seen the glamorous side of it, but in between success, you have the down periods where, you know, you're back to playing little bars and stuff again, you know, traveling in a van like I'm doing at the moment. But other times I've stayed in very expensive hotels and traveled in limos and on, you know, expensive tour buses. But, you know, you take it as it comes.
That's true. That's true. I mean, you can't take a beach house with you. And a lot of people don't understand, you know, that's what they see on the outside is the glitz and the glamour.
Yeah, well, I kind of remember seeing the Rolling Stones and Rod Stewart's huge mansions in the country, in the UK, and thinking like, well, you know, I doubt I'll get one of those, but, you know, I got a nice house, quite a big house, and from the specials royalties, you know, and I'm kind of happy. I got my mother living with me now as well, so I can look after her.
There you go. You're a good sign.
Yeah. that's the important stuff, you know.
My kids are probably going to drop me off in front of the nursing home and drive off.
Oh, dear. I hope not.
I'm just kidding. Right. They might not. I don't know. You never know. You know what I mean?
Well, I shouldn't think so.
Traveling all the time, though, that is exhausting.
Yeah, well, the older you get, the harder it gets, you know? Especially over in the States, because in the UK and Europe, the drives are a lot shorter, you know. Or you can travel from London to Scotland in 4 hours. Well, over here, sometimes we do 8-hour drives, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, the drives here suck.
Yeah. But, you know, we're playing Vegas or Arizona and that. But this time, the drives aren't too long.
So, where are you playing tonight? We're losing you. Lovely desert.
To remind myself, you know, sometimes.
I heard Bobby tell me it was a sold-out show tonight.
I think so, yeah, yeah. I think we're playing outside tonight as well, so I hope it's not too chilly later.
Chili? What is your idea of chili? Chili is here, where I am.
Yeah, well, it's below freezing back home for me, you know.
Yeah.
It's about 4 degrees below freezing in Coventry, so I've been told.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
That's crazy. So I bought a scarf and gloves when I get home. So as soon as I get off the plane, I'm going to put the scarf and gloves on and a big woolly hat.
You're going to need them. You better hope you don't get sick, though. I mean,
well, that's the problem. Me and the band have all had heavy colds and coughs this whole trip, you know.
Wow.
But we're getting by, you know. I got my throat spray and meds, so, you know, you still got, the show must go on, as they say.
That's true. Definitely, man. I'm telling you what. So, what made you, I mean, which do you prefer? I know you love the guitar. How old was you when you picked up that guitar the first time?
13.
13.
So, I'm 68 now, so I've been playing a few years. I should be better than I am, really.
But my
father played in soul bands in the 60s, trumpet player. My grandfather played trombone in an orchestra. So, like, you know, it's in the family blood.
My dad was a guitar player.
Cool, yeah.
Yeah, he tried to teach me. But he moves way too fast for me to learn. There's no way I could learn from him.
Yeah, well, with me, like, my friends would be out playing soccer, you know, in the street or wherever. And, like, I'd be sat in my bedroom playing along with old blues records, trying to work out how to do it, you know. So it's a lot of practice.
That's true. Well, you could have went out there to where they were playing soccer and just started playing for them.
They'd probably kick the ball at me.
I don't know. People love music, so there you go.
Yes, some do, some don't.
But the ones that like music suck.
Yeah, we're having a great time. You know, I've got a little nice bunch of guys playing with me, and we have a lot of fun, you know.
There you go. Are they the same guys you usually play with when you come over here?
Yeah. I've had the same band over here for, I don't know, quite a few years now. So we all know each other pretty well.
Yeah. It's nice to play with the same people.
Yeah, I got two guys that used to play with Jimmy Cliff. So they're kind of like, they can do reggae kind of stuff, you know.
I love reggae.
And I got like a kind of rockabilly bass player, double bass, kind of a punk jazz drummer. And, you know, it's a nice mixture. We cover most of the different styles.
So what is the biggest show you've ever played?
I did Roskilde in Denmark in the 90s. I think Paul Weller pulled out of that gig and we got his spot. I think it was about 300,000 people. Yeah, I've done quite some pretty big festivals. The thing is, I find, because usually in festivals, there's about a 50-foot gap between you and the crowd, so you're kind of detached, you know?
Yeah.
So it's, you just have to make big shapes and run around a lot on a big stage. But I kind of like when you're up close to the crowd, you know?
You like
dance halls and clubs, yeah. They don't pay as well, but the interaction's better, you know?
Smaller venues are better, you think?
Yeah, well just for, like, the contact, you know?
Yeah.
You got to be able to smell the crowd, you know? Like the old, roar the grease banks and smell the crowd.
Yeah, I mean, especially when they put those stages further away, you know? And then you've got all that, and the amphitheaters or whatever are back, you know what I mean? So, like, when you're up a little bit more closer, then you get a little bit
well,
personal.
Well, you can see their reactions better, you know?
Yeah, you definitely don't want somebody sitting on their phone when you're
That's
playing.
That's it, yeah. No, but that happens a lot more now. A lot of people tend to stand there with their phones.
Yeah.
Filming, you know, taking photos, which, you know.
They spend most of their time. I think when I go to, like, rock shows or shows and stuff, I think what I'll do is each band, I'll record one song and then my phone's down. Because I don't want to spend all the time on my phone. I would rather be listening to what they're doing than.
Well, that's it. All you get when you get home is a shaky, you know, film of life. And the sound's awful as well.
Yeah.
Because the burr, you know, don't record the film,
Yeah, well, also you got people talking in your ears or screaming in your ears. And
that's it, yeah.
Getting it, you know. You're getting the background noise.
I think my first major tour was supporting the Clash, you know, back in 1978 when the Specials supported the Clash, and that was a baptism of fire, you know. Back in the punk days, you come off stage covered in spit, you know.
Spit.
Wasn't very pleasant. Yeah.
They were. That's how.
Well, that was what they used to do in them days.
Oh,
even when they light you, it was a fashion, you know.
That's nasty.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
I'm sorry, that might have been a thing back then, but that is nasty. If somebody ever spit on me, oh my God, that would not go.
It's not so bad if it doesn't go in your mouth, you know? That's how Joe Strummer got hepatitis, apparently, through singing and the spit going in his mouth.
Ew.
Yeah, wonderful days.
Now we know why they have the crowds back.
Well, that's it. But I'd say the dance halls in them days, they're up close.
Wow, that is just nasty. I've never heard that until now.
Yeah, yeah. But you know, like we did some big TV programs. Like we did Saturday Night Live 1980. Like that, how many million people watched that program, you know?
A lot of people watch that program.
That's probably the way to do it. Like you could probably tour for years and never reach that many people.
I used to watch Saturday Night Live every single weekend until politics started taking over the show completely. And when politics started taking over the show, I just lost interest.
Well, the specials were always pretty political, you know. We were all pretty much left wing, you know. We didn't
But in a TV show, it's a little bit different because I mean it's supposed to be comedy, so everything cannot be about politics on a show.
no, of
You know,
course not.
it ruins it.
No.
You
Yeah,
got
yeah.
enough
I don't
people.
know, because we never got to see Saturday Night Live in the UK. I didn't see the performance we did until the 90s, you
They should bring you back on.
know. No, we did. You know what, we did a couple more in a few years ago. We did. I can't remember the name of the guy now. We
If
did
they'd
one
asked
in.
you to come back on Saturday Night Live right now, would you do it?
Probably. Yeah.
Maybe we can see if we can get that worked out.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think without the specials, like my name doesn't quite carry the same weight on my own, you know?
Will you bring the band with you?
Well, the specials, two of them are dead, and the rest of us aren't speaking.
Well, you could bring the band you have now and just take the band that you got now and just
I'd rather do that, yeah.
you just go on there, go on Saturday Night Live, Roddy Radiation, there you go.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Yeah. At
Maybe we
least
can
you get
out.
to play live anyway. You're not miming, you know.
Yeah, plus they
Maybe.
probably put you in some skits.
Well, two of my brothers did a bit of acting, but I've never really tried.
Acting's fun. It's the other side, the business side that I do, because I do both. I've been in movies, I've been on shows, and I've done both. But the business side is really a pain in the ass sometimes.
Well, I think that's the same in most things, you know. The music business is a bit well, how can I put it without swearing, you know?
Oh, I manage musicians. I already know.
Yeah,
It's a pain in the ass too. And whatever you say, it doesn't matter because this is not the type where I don't censor anything. I don't care
well.
whatever people want to say, they can say. They are free to say
Well,
what they want.
you know, you get ripped off quite a lot, you know.
Yeah.
But that's the way it is, you know. Like I say, you play music because you love it, you know.
Yeah.
So it's nice if you get a bit of money as well, but you know, take it
What
as
do
it
you think
comes.
about the streaming now? Because streaming wasn't,
Well.
it was not existent.
Well, you get very, very little money out of it.
Yeah.
You know, it's a bit of a rip off, I think. So when it was vinyl or CDs, you got fairly well paid. But now it's such a small percentage. For somebody who's starting out, you're not really going to make a lot unless you're a huge megastar, you know.
I know people, I mean, that play now, a friend of mine, in a big band who tour, they tour a lot, and he told me that, I won't say who it is, but he
Yeah.
told me that for the whole year of touring, after everything was paid for, that they only brought in like $65,000. And I told him, I was like, that's not even worth it to go and tour.
Well, yeah, well, you know, it costs a lot of money if you're in the big time, you know, to huge stages, the amount of equipment, all different road crews, you know.
Yeah.
But nowadays with me, I travel, you know, in a minibus and we roadie ourselves.
Yeah. I don't think that's fair to artists.
Well, you know, you have to go with it or you just give up, you know?
That's true. Sometimes streaming can be a good thing because it reaches a lot of people, but it's not really good when it comes to benefiting the artists financially.
Well, I like to have something I can look at my hand. You know, like a CD cover or an album cover. Yeah. I'm old school, retro, you know. Like,
me too.
You know, the way I like things to be, but, you know, it's all changed.
That's true. That is true. I don't know. There's so many things that have changed compared to the way it used to be. And sometimes, I mean, it's cool, but sometimes it's so irritating. So irritating.
It's not for the better sometimes.
No, not really.
But, you know. Well, hopefully, you know, hopefully, like, our recordings will, like, be discovered, you know, years from now. And, you know, and people will enjoy that music.
That's true. That is definitely true. So how long of a drive? You've said you've got, what, 3.5 hours left before you get to your next destination?
A couple of hours, I think. 2 hours, maybe. Yeah.
Long desert ride.
I'm not quite sure. I'm not quite sure. As long as I can get to a bathroom halfway, I don't mind.
Oh, I know. I grew up in Las Vegas, so I know those desert roads out there.
Yeah, we're not playing Vegas this time. We have in the past several times. So we did a festival there a couple of years ago. Punk Rock Bowling we did. And we played two shows. Yeah, Punk Rock Bowling in Vegas. And we played at lunchtime about 1 o'clock in the afternoon outside by the pool party, you know.
Hey, there you go. Pool parties.
It was hot as hell. Really hot. And then in the evening, we played indoors in a big ballroom. It was nice and cool there. Yeah. But it was a lot of fun.
It gets hot in Vegas.
I first went there in 94. But I've played there many times.
I think I moved from Vegas to this way. I think it was 91, 92.
Right.
Yeah. And I moved here. Yeah, it was a
while. Yeah, you missed us then.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, from what I'm hearing about Vegas, they're also tearing down one of my favorite hotels. And I just found this out and I'm kind of mad about it. The Mirage. I like the Mirage because of the fountains that catch on fire. And I found out they're tearing it down.
I have no idea. No.
It's beautiful.
I think I've seen it on the TV.
Yeah. So when are you coming back?
Next year sometime, I guess.
Next year?
You know, see how things go. I normally come over this time of year so I can escape the British weather, you know.
Yeah.
I do California in the summer, in our, you know, November time. You know, I get away from the weather and it's a bit warmer. So that's nice. Sorry?
You guys should book some shows down this way in the East Coast, like Ohio, Cincinnati.
Yeah, well, so I have done in the past, you know, but not this year, you know.
Maybe so, you can book the Blue Note. There's a venue here, and they always have a bunch of bands. And it's actually a pretty popular venue, and it's called the Blue Note.
And it's, right, I've noticed that one.
Yeah.
So I've been up and down the East Coast several times. We're doing my own thing. Obviously, with the specials, I toured all over, you know.
Yeah. I bet you're excited to go home and get some rest, though.
Yeah, I probably could do it a week in bed, yeah. But, you know, say, like, you know, I've played Japan and Australia, and I did Borneo last year. of all places, Malaysia. We did a country western festival in the middle of the jungle in Borneo. But they used to be headhunters there years ago.
That'd be cool.
It was nice. Well, it was hot, but like it was very hot, you know, that sort of damp heat, you know. And I did Hong Kong the year before that. That was Hong Kong Ska and Reggae Festival. That was a lot of fun, you know. So I still get around. I did Argentina as well a few years before that. So it's nice to go to different places.
Yeah.
Because the music's universal, like the specials music kind of reached a lot of people around the world, you know.
Yeah, I was surprised. I mean, I know that everybody has streaming, but I had heard something. It was the war that was going on over there right now in Israel, where the little girl, she made the comment on the news when the reporter was interviewing her about, I just really wanted to see Taylor Swift.
Oh, right.
The war. And I'm like, wow. You know what I mean?
I saw a thing on Facebook. There's this little girl, I'm not sure where, maybe Palestine or somewhere.
Yeah.
And they asked her some questions. And all she said was like, I'm hungry.
Wow.
That kind of brings it home, you know? Whatever the cause or whatever, who's in the right or wrong, those children are suffering. And that's a big, big problem.
Yeah, it is. It definitely is.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not going to keep you because I know you need to rest up.
Yeah, I've got my pillow there, you see.
But
so I'm really comfy.
We can do this again when you get back to UK over there.
That'd be nice. Yeah. Be more relaxed than at the moment.
Rest it up.
Thanks ever so much. Really nice talking to you.
You too. Nice to meet you. Right. Hopefully you'll come play this way.
I will do, yeah, definitely. I'll come play your front room.
Hey.
I'll bring my acoustic guitar and sing some songs.
Hey, I love it. I have my nephew come over all the time with his guitar so he can play.
Lovely.
Yeah.
Okay, now then. Right. Well, you have a good evening.
You too.
And, and you. Yeah. All right, thanks very much. Bye-bye. No.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
But the time seems so shot, yeah. Yeah.